Listening Library presents Sneaks by Katherine Egan. Read for you by Jeremy Carlisle Parker. For James. Monday, September 24th. Watches don't crawl. 1. Ben Harp saw the wristwatch scuttling sideways across the hallway, crab-like, as he and the rest of his sixth grade class filed into the library on Monday morning. It was there among the feet of his classmates, and then it was gone.
Ew! Was that a cockroach? Cried Jessica Masterson, who had nearly stepped on it. I think it was a mouse.
Audrey Banks clutched Jessica's arm. Ben had seen it clearly, if only for a second. The leather strap, the round white watch face. The strap had been curling and flattening like a caterpillar, but moving much faster than any caterpillar. A watch crawling across the hall and into the library of its own accord is hard to process at 10 in the morning, however.
Cockroach,
his brain stoutly tried to persuade him.
Or mouse.
But he felt uneasy as he sat down on the carpet in the library.
There's a cockroach on your sweater,
Jay Park yelled at Jessica Masterson. The girls shrieked at him in mock fury. Ms. Price, the school librarian, silenced them with a slight widening of her eyes. When Ms. Price first came to their school last year, the kids thought they could get away with anything because she was new and looked so young. But she disabused them of that notion very quickly. She was a petite woman, the only black teacher at their school, and the youngest by nearly 20 years. She wore big glasses with red frames and tailored outfits in bright colors. Her clothes said fun, but the expression on her face said something else altogether. Class, today we are beginning the Livingston History Project we discussed last week, said Ms. Price. I want each of you to find a partner, quietly. Even though Ben had known it was coming, his stomach dropped. This had never been a problem before sixth grade. Before, when a teacher said, find a partner, Ben and Ashok gave each other the thumbs up, and that was that. They had been best friends since first grade. But Ashok and his family had moved to Paris for the year for his mom's research. He would be back for seventh grade, but that still meant Ben had to get through the whole of sixth grade without his best friend. When Ms. Price told them to find a partner, Ben's cheeks grew hot, and he delayed a few seconds, which sealed his fate. By the time he looked around, Ryan Yu and Felix Cross had already moved closer together. Malcolm Church had partnered with Jason Huang. He looked at the other boys in his class with mounting panic. Even Danny Farkas had paired off with Jay Park. Not that he would have partnered with Danny Farkas anyway. Jake Bernstein and Lakin Bassey. That was all of the boys. The girls had made even quicker work of partnering up according to years of habit. The new girl, Akemi Hanamura, was sitting next to Ben on the carpet. She glanced at him for a second or two, but he felt strangely frozen by the situation and avoided meeting her eyes. Akemi had made the lethal mistake, during her first week at Livingston Middle School, of beating out Jessica Masterson for captain of the girls' basketball team in tryouts. Jessica Masterson, and the whole town really, was fanatical about basketball. Jessica Masterson was also the undisputed queen of sixth grade. Akemi was shut out after that. Now she looked resignedly at Charlotte Moss, who had a face like wobbly rice pudding and always smelled of instant noodle soup. Akemi didn't have any other choices, though. She moved closer to Charlotte on the carpet. Does everybody have a partner? Asked Ms. Price. Murmured yeses. Ben's no got stuck in his throat. Good. Her eyes skated across the class. Ben Harp, who is your partner?
I don't have one.
It came out too quiet. Ms. Price frowned, leaning forward. I can't hear you, she said. This time, it came out too loud.
I don't have a partner.
Danny Farkas snickered and then fell silent under Ms. Price's frosty glare. I forgot that we're an uneven number, said Ms. Price. Join Akemi and Charlotte to form a group of three, please. Class, you have 2 weeks to complete the project. This will be a lot of work, so I hope you'll all start early rather than leaving it for the last minute. I want it back Monday, October 8th.
October 8th? Cried Jessica Masterson. But we have our first basketball game against Ryland Middle School that day. We need to practice a lot. Our team isn't very good this year.
She shot Akemi a venomous look, muttering something that sounded like new captain. If you can't balance your extracurricular activities with your schoolwork, you shouldn't be on the team, said Ms. Price, handing out work packets. Ben Harp, join your group, please. Danny Farkas smirked at Ben. Ben missed Ashok worse than ever. Ashok, who seemed, whenever they texted each other, to be having such an amazing time in Paris, who actually liked his new school and had already made new friends just 3 weeks in. Akemi smiled brightly at him. Charlotte gave him her standard blank rice pudding stare. He felt, for a moment, so lonely and miserable that he almost forgot about the watch crawling into the library. 2. Ms. Kennedy was frantically searching her desk when they returned to their classroom. The worst thing about sixth grade was that Ashok was gone. The second worst thing was having Ms. Kennedy for homeroom and language arts. Her baseline was a slow, simmering fury. She had frizzy, dyed red hair, her ankles puffed out around the edges of her shoes, and she smelled like stale coffee. Unhappiness came off her in waves and hung in the air of the classroom. They breathed it in all day.
Has anybody seen my watch? She cried as they returned to their desks. I left it right here.
She gestured wildly at the stacks of papers and folders, the coffee-stained mugs, the pens and rubber bands and chains of paper clips all jumbled together on her desk. Ben thought queasily of what he'd seen outside the library. But it was impossible to say, yes, I saw your watch crawl right past Jessica Masterson's feet and into the library about an hour ago. So he said nothing. Cockroach or mouse, his brain insisted. Watches don't crawl.
No, Ms. Kennedy, I haven't seen it, said Bryony Moore earnestly.
Bryony Moore was the biggest suck-up in all of suck-up-dom.
Do you want us to look for it?
Ms. Kennedy stared at her desk for a moment, like it was her worst enemy and she was getting ready to lay a curse on it. Then she turned that same look on them. Ben sank down into his seat.
Open your workbooks, she said menacingly. We're doing reading response.
Akemi caught up with Ben as he was getting his bicycle after school.
Hi,
she said.
Hi.
She was the same height as him. Her black hair was cut in a neat bob, and she had a frank, cheerful expression. If she hadn't been so dumb as to beat Jessica Masterson in that one-on-one basketball face-off, she'd probably have made friends here easily. Charlotte Moss came lolling along behind her, mouth slightly open. They made an odd pair. Akemi in her trendy sportswear, Charlotte in her pleated skirt and high-button blouse, like a 1950s schoolgirl.
So, the Livingston History Project, said Akemi. Should we start it today? This Agatha Ben person we're supposed to interview lives pretty close. I mean, everywhere in this town is close, I guess.
She rolled her eyes.
Charlotte found her address online.
The project had two parts. They had to interview somebody, chosen by Ms. Price, who had lived their whole life in Livingston, and write a report on that person's memories of the town and how it had changed. And they had to research a monument or building in town, which they could choose themselves. Ben wanted to say no. He wanted to be alone and think about the crawling watch. His brain was trying a different tack and was now telling him, hallucination. A weird virus.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.